Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Dr. Muhammad Adnan, working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Physics, Kohat University of Science and Technology. I welcome you to the course PHY481 Plasma Physics. It is the 16th lecture of this course, and the topic is magnetic mirror. First, I will give the learning objectives. At the end of this lecture, the student will understand the motion of charge particle in an inhomogeneous magnetic field, and also they will be able to understand the concept of mirror force in a magnetic field structure. In this course, we are following the book Introduction to Plasma Physics and Control Fusion by F.F. Chen, 3rd edition. In this lecture, I have taken some of the illustrations from this book. Before we start with the topic magnetic mirror, what we have done before in this course, we have discussed the motion of charged particle, say the charge of that charged particle is Q in the presence of electric and magnetic field governed by the Lorentz force equation or with the help of external force. And we have studied initially this equation of motion for a charged particle in the presence of static electric field and magnetic field. And then we introduced various forces, gravitational force, the gradient in the field lines, also the curvature in the magnetic field profile. And first, we have discussed only the V cross B situation, that is for static uniform magnetic field having no electric field and no external force, and we managed to obtain the equation of motion and concluded that once the magnetic field is uniform directed along, say, in the z direction, and we solve this QV cross B parallel to the magnetic field and also perpendicular to the magnetic field, and we concluded that the presence of uniform magnetic field do not affect the parallel motion, that is the z component of the velocity remains the same, while the other two velocities, the vx and vi, is having this periodic solution, that is it gives you that gyro motion. And we conclude that once the charged particle enter perpendicular to the magnetic field, it will experience that V cross B force. And if it possesses that finite parallel velocity, so it will go along the magnetic field, and due to that V cross B, it will gyrate with the cyclotron frequency. And we noted that angle, which is the pitch angle. We will focus on this thing in this lecture. That angle is known as the angle of obliqueness once the uniform field, once the field is uniform. But once we have an inhomogeneous field, then this angle is the angle between the velocity vector of the charged particle, say a proton in this case, and the local magnetic field, since the magnetic field is varying, so that it will be at that particular point where the charged particle is moving, it will be at that angle. And we managed to obtain these gyro frequencies and gyro radius by the force balancing, that is solving these in the respective axes. Now, after imposing an external force causes the particle drift across the magnetic field, but not simple in the direction of the external force. So after that, once we have managed to understand that Q V cross B force on the charged particle when a uniform magnetic field is there. Then we introduce various external force so that this equation of motion is again split into the parallel and perpendicular direction relative to the magnetic field. And if that external force acts parallel to the magnetic field, so it will simply accelerate the charged particle parallel to the magnetic field. That is, once the external field is acting parallel to the magnetic field, so it will accelerate with that constant magnitude. That is, it will add to that initial parallel velocity by this thing. And if that force act perpendicular to the magnetic field, that is, that force which is the external force act perpendicular to the magnetic field, we term those forces as the cross force. That is, let's say this force, external force, is electric field which is having a component perpendicular to the magnetic field, so we term that E cross B drift. If there is a gradient in the magnetic field direction, then there is a grade B drift. If there is a curvature in the magnetic field lines, there will be a force perpendicular to the magnetic field direction. So the parallel force give rise to acceleration parallel to the magnetic field direction, while external force which is applied perpendicular to the magnetic field, it will add to the drift. That is, that gyro motion will be coupled with that drift. That is, the guiding center will drift now because of that externally applied field which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So force affect radius of the gyro motion resulting in drift orthogonal to both B and the external force. That is, once that perpendicular force is applied along with the uniform field, so there will be a guiding center drift that will be both perpendicular to the B and the external force. And this can be different for the different charge particles depending upon the polarity. Sometime it depends and sometime it is independent. And based on these equation of motion, we have managed to discuss the various scenario. For example, we have discussed the gravitational drift when a gravitational force is there perpendicular to the direction of the magnetic field, so there the guiding center will drift perpendicular to both the gravitational direction and also the magnetic field direction. We have also discussed the situation where an externally applied field, electric field, is applied perpendicular to the magnetic field. It will give rise to the E cross B drift. Similarly, we have discussed the grade B drift, which is if there is a gradient in the field field lines, that is, the density of the field line varies in a direction perpendicular to the applied field, so it will give rise to a guiding center drift with the charged particle will experience, and that drift will be perpendicular to both the field and also that force which is introduced. Also, we have discussed the curvature drift. Once the charged particle is moving on a field which is having a curvedness in the profile, so that it will experience an outward force, the centrifugal force, and that force is when act along with the magnetic field, that is, that drift will be there, so it will affecting the gyro motion, that is, the charged particle again will be drifting in a direction that will be perpendicular to both the curvature direction and also the B direction. So these are the guiding center drift that we have discussed. So now we will be discussing the situation of a charged particle which is moving in a magnetic field profile such that there is a converging field such that the field strength is stronger at one place than the other places, so that the charged particle will again experiencing those guiding center drift. But our discussion will be mainly focused on this fact, that is, gyrating particle constitute an electric current loop with a dipole moment which is equal to half mv perp square over b square, where b is the magnetic field strength, which v perp is the perpendicular velocity of the charged particle that enters in that field regime. Now, we know that this dipole moment is conserved, that is, it's invariant, that is, whether the charged particle is moving in a region where the magnetic field is slightly weaker than a region where the magnetic field is somehow stronger, so that this will remain constant, that is, it will be invariant. So, that invariant is due to the fact that once the B field is increasing as the charged particle is moving from this region to this region, the perpendicular component of the velocity will also increase such that to compensate their change, and this magnetic moment will be invariant. We will see mathematically these things in this lecture, but the mirroring force is related with this concept, that the magnetic moment of a charged particle which is moving, so that magnetic moment will remain constant. So, the fact, as I told you, that since mu is a constant of motion, so even if B changes, if B varies spatially or temporally, if B varies, then the perpendicular component of the velocity varies to keep mu constant. So that once the V perp changes, that means V parallel also changes, just to validate that conservation of energy as well. Since if V perp increases, that means V parallel will decrease, such that the total energy possessed by the charged particle remains the same. So it gives rise to magnetic mirroring, and these some of the physical situation. One can see the planetary magnetosphere, the coronal loop, and other various plasma environments. So in this lecture, we will be talking about how a charged particle is experiencing that mirroring force, which compel the charged particle to be trapped in a region. For that, to understand mathematically, let we have a magnetic field which is two-dimensional, that is BR and BZ, in cylindrical geometry. Consider a B field is in the Z direction and whose magnitude varies in the Z direction. If B field is axisymmetric, that is, this Q is basically theta, that is the theta component is zero, and also the rate of change with respect to theta is also zero. This Q is theta. Since in cylindrical geometry we have three coordinate R, theta and Z, so the field, the magnetic field is having R and Z, and the theta component is zero. So we need to see this thing. How does this configuration of the magnetic field give rise to a force that trap a charged particle? That is, we need to see how the charged particle is confined to a region due to a force which is there because of the magnetic field structures. So we need to see this mathematically. So we start with this del dot B equal to zero, and obtaining the radial component of that magnetic field through this equation. So in the cylindrical geometry, if we apply this del dot B, it will be of this form. Now, in order to obtain that B of R, we need to assume that the rate of change of this magnetic field with respect to Z at the origin is given. You will see that in a minute. So if we just rearrange this equation, we'll be getting this thing. So that if we, as I told you, that if BZ over Z is given at R equal to 0, that is at the origin, and does not change much with R, so then if we solve this thing, or we can say this integrating this thing, so that here we'll be left with BR, and if we integrate this thing from 0 to say R, such that this BZ over Z, as I told you, is somehow constant, so we're left with R, such that if we differentiate this R, this will be 1 over 2 R square, and we'll need to put the limit 0 to R, so we'll be getting this thing. So from this assumption, we can say that this BR will be equal to minus 1 over 2 R, and then the magnitude of that change at R equal to 0. So we'll be using this B of R, or the radial component of the magnetic field, that is, it changes with R. Now we'll use this expression on the next slide just to understand that mirroring force. So now that we have that BR in terms of BZ, which we'll be using in the Lorentz force to find out the various component. So if we just equate that force equal to qv cross b, such that v is having three components, the radial, the angular, and the z component. So this is just solving qv cross b, such that magnetic field is having two components, z and r. These theta components are anyway zero, but we need to write the complete form. So this is the force, the same force, the equation of motion, F is equal to Q V cross B, such that the magnetic field profile is in this lecture while understanding the magnetic mirror is given by this two-dimensional field. So that if we split the QV cross B force, we'll be having these components. As I told you, B theta is zero as we have taken the axis symmetric field. These two components are anyway zero because the magnetic field along theta is zero. Now, we have these four various components responsible for various effects on the charge particle. For example, these two, as I told you, the B theta is zero, so these two terms are cancelled out, and this one and second term give rise to the Larmor gyration, which we have already discussed in the previous lecture. And also I have summarized in the first part of this lecture, that is these components will give rise to the same gyro motion which we have discussed, but we have discussed those things in the XYZ coordinate, but it is the same thing if we just move to the cylindrical geometry. The third term, again, that BR, and there is a parallel velocity, so that this term vanishes on the axis and causes a drift in the radial direction. As I told you, that once there is an external force act along with the magnetic field, so it gives rise to a drift. As I told you, that BR changes with R, so that there is a force that will cross with the magnetic field, so it will give rise to a drift. But as I told you, we have discussed the gyro motions and the drift in the previous lecture. What is left for this lecture is the understanding of this factor, which is responsible for the force along Z, that is along the field line, just to trap the charged particle with this force. So all other terms are either zero. These two are zero because the magnetic field is having B theta is zero. These two gave rise to the gyro motion, and this gave rise to a drift because this BR depends on R. So if we, as I told you, that if there is a force which act perpendicular to the magnetic field direction, so initially the B field is applied in such a way that it will give rise to a drift in the theta coordinate. And as I told you, that this is that force that we will focus on just to understand the magnetic mirroring effect. Now, this force which is along the Z coordinate, or we can say the field direction, if we just put the value of BR which we have obtained on the previous slide, so if we put that BR over here, and this V theta is nothing but V perp, so if we use that thing, so that we can have the magnitude of that force which is responsible for the mirroring effect. So after this slide, we'll be mainly tuning this equation just to relate that this thing with the magnetic moment. As I told you, that will be mainly concerned with the invariant first adiabatic invariance of the magnetic moment, so that beyond this slide we'll be just tuning this equation, which is the force which is responsible for the back and forth motion in a field profile, which is given by such a structure which we have discussed on the previous slide. So as I told you, that V theta is nothing but the component of the velocity in the perpendicular direction relative to the field, and this R is nothing but the Larmor radius. So if we use those two things, so the equation is further tuned. Now, as I told you, this is called the mirror force, that plus minus sign arises because particle of opposite charge orbit the field in the opposite direction. So just to cover the polarity effect of the charge, we can have this plus minus sign. Now, if we just open that Larmor radius in terms of the cyclotron frequency that we have done in this course right throughout, so we can have this force, which is the force responsible for the mirroring effect, that will be equal to half mv per square over b, and then we have the rate of change of that b with respect to z. So just go back to the previous slide. Initially, I told you that this half mv per square over b is the magnetic moment. So that we can express this a force equal to minus mu and then rate of change of the magnetic field, where this mu is half mv square, and then b, that v square is the perpendicular component of the velocity. Now, we can write this in a more general form by this thing, that this Vz is nothing but force experienced by the charged particle parallel to the field direction, since Z is the parallel direction, equal to minus mu, which is the magnetic moment, times the rate of change of the magnetic field. Since if we make this V perp, so this is just the S is the line element along B, and this F parallel is the mirroring force parallel to the magnetic field, and as I told you, this ds is a lensing element along the B, which can be expressed in a more general form in the 3D by minus mu del parallel times B. So that mirroring force can be expressed in terms of magnetic moment. So next we'll see the consequences of this force. So as a particle moves into regions of stronger or weaker magnetic field, Larmor radius changes, but mu remains invariant. As I told you, this is a fact that once a charged particle orbiting along a magnetic field, so it gives rise to a tiny current and gives rise to a magnetic moment, and that magnetic moment is a constant of motion. Now, to prove this, consider the parallel component of the equation of motion, mv parallel square equal to minus mu db over ds, that we have written on the previous slide. So that if we multiply both sides of this equation with v parallel, so that here we will be having a v parallel on this side, and also on this side we will be having a v parallel. Now this equation can be expressed in terms of this equation, that is, this half v parallel dv parallel over dt can be expressed by d over dt of half mv parallel square. That is, if we apply this derivative, this half m is a constant factor, such that this will be 2, the 2 will be cancels out, and then v parallel minus 1, and then dv parallel over dt, such that we'll be getting the exact form mv parallel dv parallel over dt from this side. And also we can express that v parallel as ds over dt. As I told you, this is just a line element parallel to the magnetic field, so this ds over dt is nothing but a velocity in the parallel direction to the magnetic field, so that one can have this minus mu v parallel db over ds. So that this can be expressed as minus mu, and that's the db over dt. So that we started with the parallel component of the equation of motion, and we managed to write this in terms of the derivative of the kinetic energy in the parallel direction equal to minus mu db over dt. As I told you, in order to make the mu, which is the magnetic moment, constant, the perpendicular component of the velocity changes, and hence the parallel velocity will also change, but during that the energy remains conserved, and that is the rate of change of the total energy in the respective coordinates will be zero. That is, this thing is constant. If the derivative is zero, that means this thing is constant. So that if v perp changes when the charged particle moves from stronger to weaker regime, v perpendicular changes. So in order to compensate their change for the energy conservation, the v parallel must also change. So this energy conservation can be expressed in terms of mu. So as I told you, mu is half m v perp square over b. So that this half m v perp square can be expressed as mu b. That is, if you multiply both sides by b, so that we'll be having mu b equal to half m v perp square. So this can be converted to mu b, which is done over here. That's the same conservation energy can be d by dt of half mv per square plus instead of half mv per square can be expressed in terms of mu, that is mu b. Again, if we use that dB over there, so that this half mv per square from this thing can be expressed as minus mu dB over dt, so that this expression takes the form d over dt of half mv per square, which is exactly this thing, that is equal to minus mu dB over dt, which is over here. And this d over dt will be also applied on this thing, so that is d over dt of mu b. That is, if we apply this differential operator on these two terms, so the first term will be minus mu dB over dt, and the second term is the same thing. So if we apply the product rule over there, so this term is the same, minus mu dB over dt, and here this will split into two, such that we need to apply this operator on mu first, on b first, and then on mu, so that we'll be having these two terms. Now these two terms can be cancels out, because these are just the same thing with opposite sign, so we'll be left with b mu d mu over dt. Now from this thing, it is clear that b cannot be equal to zero. The magnetic field is a two-dimensional field, as I told you. So that means that this d mu over dt is zero. That is mu, which is the magnetic moment, that is invariant. So solving those equations, we have managed to prove that this magnetic moment will remain constant during the charged particle motion. As it moves from stronger region to weaker region, this mu will remain constant. So when mu is constant, that means to make this mu constant, as it is clear from this expression, this m is constant, this 1 over 2 is constant, so either v per and b will change in such a way that this will remains constant. So when a charged particle moves in a region of stronger magnetic field, so that vb will also increase just to make this mu constant. So as I told you, as b is not equal to zero, that implies that this d mu over dt is equal to zero, and hence this mu is constant in time, that is, it is invariant. Which this mu is known as the first adiabatic invariant of the particle orbit. We'll discuss these invariants in the coming lectures, but here we are just focusing on the effect of the mirroring force. So as I told you, as a particle moves from a weaker to a stronger field region, it sees B increasing, and therefore the V perp must increase in order to keep mu constant. Since the total energy must remain constant, that means V parallel must decrease. So as the charged particle moves in a stronger region, a field of stronger region, the parallel component of the velocity is practically zero, that is, it will not going through that throat of the structure that we will see in a minute. So that it will, because that V parallel must decrease in order to increase the V perpendicular, just to make the mu constant. So if B is high enough, this V parallel essentially goes to zero, and particle is reflected back to a weak field region. So as I told you, we will see the consequences of this invariant mu, which we have seen mathematically, and that give rise to that mirroring force, which we have obtained through that equation of motion. So we'll see further what will be the effect of this invariance of the magnetic moment. So that is our next task. So consider we have a magnetic structure of various intensity such that one region is configured through B naught and the other one is B1. In the weak and strong region, such that B1 is strong, that is the converging field is strong, and we have a slightly weaker field over there. Associated with the speed, so that the total velocity is V0 when the field is B0, and it is V1 when the field is B1. So we have two B field of different strength, so that it give rise to different speeds. And then of course this V0 will be having V parallel and V perpendicular, and this V1 will also be having V parallel and V perpendicular. The conservation of mu implies that this factor mv0 square over 2b0 must be equal to mv1 square over 2b1. So if we have, practically speaking, the v parallel are 0, so that the two velocity v0 and v1 is equal to v0 per and v1 per square. So the conservation requires that the b fields are different, so hence the velocities are different, just to make the magnetic moment is constant. So as B increases, the perpendicular component of the particle velocity increases. As we have discussed, particle moves more and more perpendicular to B, as I told you, and practically the V parallel will decrease. Since there is no accelerating mechanism, at the beginning of this lecture I told you, if there is an accelerating mechanism applied parallel to the field, so it will give rise to an accelerated motion parallel to the field line. But since there is no electric field applied, so practically the V parallel must decrease, and the particle will slow down as it gyrating along these field lines and reaches to a stronger field. So it will, practically the V parallel will be zero, and it will be moving to a slightly weaker region, that it will be just reflecting back. If field is strong enough at some point, the particle may have V parallel equal to zero, as I told you. At B1, as I told you, stronger region, V parallel is zero, and from the conservation of energy, if V parallel is zero, that means whatever velocity the particle is having, that will be V perp square. So that this V1 square equal to V1 square perp, and that's equal to the total. So that is the same thing. At the beginning, I told you that if we find out the from the figure defining the sine theta from the figure, so that will be clear. But first we need to eliminate these constants. So this thing is equal to this thing, so m will be cancels out, this 2 will be cancels out, and we'll be left with b over b1 equal to v0 square per over v1 square per. And the same thing as I told you, defining the sine theta, which is the pitch angle, I told you that angle, which is the angle between the velocity vector of the charged particle with that local magnetic field, since we have variation in the field. So that that will be equal to V perp over V naught, and then that V perp over V naught is equal to B naught over B1, so that sine square theta is equal to B naught over B1. So particle with smaller theta will mirror in regions of higher B. If theta is too small, that is that theta, as I told you, B1 is different than B0. So if that is too small, because this B1 is somehow greater than the B0, the particle do not mirror. And mirror ratio is defined as BM over naught, you see this is the structure of the magnetic field such that we have different profile of the B field, and the plasma, we can say the charge particle trapped between the magnetic mirrors. So the smallest theta of a confined particle is equal to, as I told you, equal to 1 over r. So this defined region in velocity space in a shape of a cone called the last cone. So if a particle is in a region between two high fields, the particle may be reflected at one, travel towards the second, and also reflect there. Thus, particle motion is confined in a region of space. This process is known as the magnetic trapping, or we can say magnetic mirroring. So with this, I thank you for your time.